Murder on Mustique by Anne Glenconner. Read by Harriet Walter and Ben Bailey-Smith. Part 1.
Tropical Weather Outlook. National Hurricane Center, Miami, Florida. Friday, 13th September 2002. For the North Atlantic and Caribbean Sea. The National Hurricane Center is issuing advisories on Tropical Storm Cristobal, located 100 miles east of the South Carolina coast. Cyclone tracking southeast, current risk rating mild.
Prologue, Friday the 13th of September, 2002. It's 5 a.m. when Amanda Fortini strolls through the palm trees in a red bikini to Britannia Bay. She's barefoot, still slightly drunk after last night's party. Her skin is tanned from diving on the island's coral reef and lazing by friends' swimming pools, her blonde hair two shades lighter than when she arrived in Mustique 6 weeks ago. She pauses for a moment, inhaling the island's smell of wild vines, hibiscus flowers, and adventure. The scent lifts her spirits higher as she follows the track through shoulder-high ferns. She's 23 years old and feels in charge of her life for the first time ever. She has made mistakes and picked the wrong men, even though her life as a New York socialite has introduced her to many eligible bachelors, but no more. Certainty fills her mind as the ocean comes into view, a glitter of turquoise filling the horizon. The young woman smiles as she surveys the beach, its pink-tinged sand unfolding in a wide crescent. The heat is increasing already, even though she's on the western side of the island, the newly risen sun warming her back. It's still so early, there's no one in sight. The ocean beckons her closer, tempting her to sprint into the waves like an overexcited child. She can do just as she likes here. No journalists are hiding among the trees, waiting to ambush her like they do in Manhattan, making her permanently self-conscious. Celebrity is the price she pays for belonging to a wealthy family, but its demands are constant. Every detail of her life is pored over on the pages of the glossy magazines. Mustique is the one place she can relax without witnesses. That heady sense of freedom makes her spin in a pirouette, taking in the jungle's depths, a pristine white villa on the hilltop, and the sun dropping coins of light onto the water's surface. The Caribbean is as calm as a basin of mercury, waiting to welcome her. Amanda walks into the sea, slowly at first, letting it erase last night's heat from her skin when she danced by a fire on the beach. A huge yacht hovers on the horizon ahead, its decks glinting in the sunlight. She allows the next tall wave to lift her off her feet. Her muscles feel loose and relaxed as she sets out from shore, arms and legs cutting through the water in a rapid crawl. She turns only once to catch her breath. Mustique looks like an advert for tropical holidays as she treads water. Its hills rise above her, circled by acres of tall trees and deserted beaches. Amanda floats on her back, content to drift for a while, turning her face to the sun. A faint noise starts up while she admires the island's lush profile. She can hear the ugly mechanical whir of a speedboat growing louder all the time. It could be a local fisherman or the yacht's owner, but why is it going so fast? Everyone knows that there are swimmers in the water all day long. When she spins round, a motorboat is racing straight towards her. Instinct makes her dive below the water's surface until her lungs burn. The boat's propeller misses her face by inches. Didn't the driver see her waving frantically to make it change course? The boat spins in a tight circle, panic flooding her system as she dives again. When it speeds towards her for a third time, her reactions are too slow. The boat's prow tosses her into the air like a rag doll until she plummets back down into the water. Faces of people she loves flicker past her eyes, her mother, her best friends. Amanda is barely conscious when she surfaces, the waves' tumult ringing in her ears. Her gaze lands on the island again, like a camera lens, taking a last shot of paradise.
Chapter 1. Saturday, the 14th of September, 2002. My hands hover over a cardboard box with the words Princess Margaret scrawled on its lid. I'm at home in my Norfolk farmhouse this morning, completing a task I've delayed for months. I already know what the box contains. Every present the princess gave me during my 4 decades as her lady-in-waiting. I've let it stand in my attic since her funeral, 7 months ago. Princess Margaret's letters lie in neat bundles, bearing my full title, Lady Blake, in her flamboyant handwriting. The sight of them brings a lump to my throat. She always wrote to me if we were parted by illness or family duties, but I can't bear to reread them yet. I only need to choose an item for my goddaughter Lily Calder's 21st birthday, because the glamorous world the princess occupied has always fascinated her. The sight of so many presents makes time slip backwards. Delicate white china egg cups traced with gold, a turquoise silk scarf, and a soap dish carved from ebony. The princess loved to give items with a practical value, taking great care selecting each one. They trigger memories of royal tours and the glitter of flash bulbs that surrounded her, flattering at first, then cruel, in the months before her death. I pick up the silk scarf to admire it again. It's the first present the princess gave me after Jasper bought Mustique on a whim in 1955, long before the island had electricity or running water. It will make an ideal present for Lily, especially when she hears about its origin. I know the princess wouldn't object to it being passed on. She always loved possessions being put to good use. It's a relief when the telephone rings at 9:30 a.m., before the past can swallow me whole. I feel certain it'll be my husband offloading his worries, but the voice at the end of the line belongs to my goddaughter. I've looked after Lily for the past 16 years, ever since her mother died. She lives in our villa on Mustique, but I wasn't expecting her to call home. The island is 5 hours behind the UK, so she must have risen before dawn. Her voice sounds breathless, yet she doesn't explain what's wrong. I listen to her describe how she's been spending her time running the conservation project her mother started so many years ago to save the reef that protects the island. She's worked like a trooper on it every summer since she hit her teens and full-time since completing her marine biology degree in July. Volunteers have been helping her replant live coral onto areas bleached white by pollutants and the sea's rising temperature. Anyone with a less well-tuned ear would miss the anxiety in her voice.
There's nothing else to report, V. I just wanted to touch base.
You're up terribly early, darling. Is everything okay? She hesitates for a beat too long.
Fine. I'm looking forward to seeing you, that's all. You and Jasper will be here for my birthday, won't you?
We wouldn't miss it for the world. I'm flying over next weekend, so we'll have a week to decide what you'd like to do. And Jasper's promised to join us. I hear her take a long breath, like she's trying not to cry. Something's wrong, isn't it? I wait for her reply. Silence is always the best way to break down Lily's reticence. The girl has a sunny disposition, but the anniversary of her mother's death is looming, which always knocks her off balance.
Amanda was meant to come over last night, but she never arrived.
Maybe she forgot. Why not pop round later today?
It's been a strange week. I heard footsteps on my way home from Basil's bar a few nights ago. I think someone followed me.
Are you sure? It could have been someone staggering back to their villa after too many cocktails.
You may be right,
she says, her voice steadying.
Let me know when you're arriving once you have details. I'll collect you.
Spend the day with friends, Lily. I hate the idea of you alone in that great big house.
I'm okay, honestly. There's plenty of work to do on my boat.
You're allowed to relax occasionally, darling. I shall distract you with picnics and gossip the minute I touch down. She gives a quiet laugh.
That's what I need. I've been missing you.
Me too. But we'll be together soon. I end our conversation by telling Lily I love her, then say goodbye. The tension in her voice stays with me after our conversation ends. She never makes a fuss unless there's a genuine emergency. She must have been working too hard if she's worried about being followed in one of the safest places in the world. The girl is more inclined to fret about the needs of others than her own, which is why I'm planning a huge surprise party to honour her birthday. I want her to know how much she means to Jasper and me and our grown-up children. Raising her has been a pleasure, yet she never seems fully confident about her place in our family. My thoughts remain with Lily as I peer into the box again. The next item I select is a rope of citrine beads, which trigger happier memories. Princess Margaret gave them to me because they would look perfect with my favourite dress. I'm about to put the box back in the attic when my phone rings for a second time. I can tell it's my husband from the angry silence at the end of the line. The man's temper is so mercurial he can shift from charm to abject fury in moments. Jasper, is that you?
Who else would it be?
He snaps. A friend, perhaps, or one of the children?
Oh, V, for God's sake. Everything is falling apart out here. I should ditch the whole project.
What do you mean?
Bloody architect's an imbecile. The villas are a disaster. And the casuarina trees I wanted saved have all been felled. I might as well throw in the towel.
His voice is rising in pitch, warning me that he's set to explode. You'll get things back on track, I say calmly. Listen to me, Jasper, please. I'm flying to Mustique next Saturday to prepare for Lily's birthday party. Promise me you'll collect the costumes and bring them over in good time. It's not just a family affair. People are flying in from all over the world.
It's a fortnight away, for goodness sake. You've spoken of nothing else for months.
Remember, it's a surprise. You mustn't breathe a word to anyone, especially Lily.
I can keep a secret, V, you know that. Oh, I wish you could see the Caribbean. It's crystal clear today. Not a cloud in the sky. It's like the days when we slept in a tent on Mustique, weren't they marvellous?
Apart from the wretched mosquitoes. Jasper laughs.
Poor thing. One bite and the whole swarm descended on you.
Don't remind me.
Philip's over here cheering me up. Don't you miss us all?
Yes, of course.
Do you remember how it began, on Mustique? We fished for lobsters in the lagoon with our bare hands and basked in the sun all day. It was my idea of paradise.
The stress in Jasper's voice has been replaced by yearning, his gentle side coming to the fore. My husband has been in St. Lucia for the past fortnight, overseeing his latest project, creating a beachside community of villas to rival the cachet of Mustique. I won't let myself ask how much it's costing, because it's already consumed a huge amount of his fortune. I've spent my life observing his mood swings, delighting in the highs and weathering the lows. It's better to forget the money that flows so easily through his fingers and concentrate on the future. When I put down the phone, the apple trees outside my window are shedding their leaves. It's the start of autumn's slow decline, my least favourite time of the year, because it reminds me that I'm 70 years old. But my parents were inspired by a particularly stalwart heroine in a novel by H.G. Wells, choosing to give me her middle name, Veronica. I always try to follow her example. Instinct tells me to change my plans and fly to Mustique this afternoon to be with Lily. I shall book my ticket and go. Without delay.
Chapter 2. D.S. Solomon Niall is in his office, wondering how to fill his day. He's only been in post 3 months, his role as Mustique's only fully trained police officer resting uneasily on his shoulders. He flew home from the UK in June, and summer had passed without a single incident, giving him no excuse to request a deputy to safeguard the island's territory. The police chief on St. Vincent would laugh out loud if he claimed that Mustique needed another officer. The island of his birth is just 3 miles long, by 1.5 miles wide, with no record of crime. Any wrongdoing would result in a spell in St. Vincent's jail, 25 miles away, and permanent exclusion from the privately owned island. Niall needs to impress his senior officers during his probation period. His father is sick, and at 30 he's the oldest of 2 sons. A large part of his wage is spent on the old man's medicines. This police job isn't the one he dreamed of, but loyalty and a need to make decisions about his future made him accept it. He's helped his father raise his younger brother Lyra ever since his mother died when he was 7 years old. The job gives him breathing space, even though his workplace is only large enough to accommodate a battered desk and 2 plastic chairs, the air conditioning unit grinding noisily all day long but failing to lower the temperature. The starched white shirt and black trousers of his uniform may look smart, but they're not fit for purpose when the temperature outside is touching 80 degrees. The detective glances through the half-open door at his colleagues playing cards, Winston and Charlie Layton. The brothers are a decade older than him, out of shape from sitting down 90% of the time, the word security emblazoned on their yellow t-shirts. Niall wouldn't trust either man in a crisis. Niall does a double take when the phone on his desk rings for the first time in weeks. He listens to Lily Calder in silence, her voice low and compelling, already on his feet by the time she says that someone is missing. Her friend Amanda Fortini was meant to visit her last night, but she never arrived, and she's not answering her phone. The young woman should be easy to trace. Only a few dozen villa owners have remained on the island at the end of the season. The majority have flown home to avoid the tropical storm that's making slow but inexorable progress across the Atlantic, their time on Mustique just a temporary break from reality. The Layton brothers are too immersed in their poker game to say goodbye when Niall takes his leave. He glances back at the police building and feels another stab of disappointment. Niall won a place to study history at Oxford University at 18, certain that the world was his oyster. But his view has changed since he returned home. His office has badly fitted windows, 2 makeshift holding cells built from breeze blocks, and a corrugated iron roof that's sure to leak when autumn's tropical rainstorms arrive. He plans to ask the police chief on St. Vincent to modernise the place once he completes his probation in 6 months' time. The detective's mood improves as he mounts the off-road dune buggy that comes with his role. It's the quickest way to cover the island's mixed terrain and the best perk of his job, even though it takes 3 attempts to start the motor. He could walk to the Fortini's villa, but the trade winds have stopped blowing, breathless heat surrounding him as the buggy sets off. The police station lies in a section of the island that few holidaymakers visit. Most simply check into their villas and remain there, only emerging for cocktails at Basil's Bar, Firefly or the Cotton House before jetting home. Niall scans the dense thickets that lie beyond the stone-paved path. The island has changed a great deal since his childhood, but the developers have retained the illusion of a tropical jungle, even though almost 100 villas lie hidden among the trees. When he was a boy, turtles still crawled onto the beaches to lay their eggs, and red-footed tortoises roam the jungles. The island's wildlife still includes plenty of birds. A green-tailed parakeet flits overhead as he passes Britannia Bay, where a few holidaymakers are taking a dip, their beach towels the only spots of colour on the pale sand. The detective's curiosity rises as he parks his buggy outside the Fortini's holiday home. It looks more like a fairy tale palace than a villa, with huge terraces built into the side of the hill. It's one of the most impressive properties on Mustique, which isn't surprising. The Fortini coffee empire is the largest in the world. Niall has always wondered what the place looks like inside, and today he'll finally see for himself. One of his neighbours from Lavelle is sweeping the porch when Niall climbs the steps to the entrance. He's known the middle-aged woman all his life, yet suddenly she's unwilling to meet his eye. It's not the first time his police badge has drawn a cool reception. When he asks if Amanda Fortini is at home, she tells him to speak to the housekeeper. She'll be fussing in the kitchen by now. The cleaner shoos him inside with a waft of her hand, returning to her job of sweeping invisible dust from the terrace before he's even said goodbye. When Niall catches his reflection in a window, he's suddenly reminded of the mismatch between his stature and his self-image. He's 6'5", almost as tall as Usain Bolt, his shoulders thick with muscles earned from swimming all year round, but that's where the similarity ends. Niall has the sprinter's physique, but none of his swagger. His brown eyes are shielded by circular glasses with thin gold frames, which make him look studious rather than athletic. His gaze contains curiosity, but little confidence. The policeman stifles a whistle of admiration when he enters the hallway. It's more like a cathedral than a private home. Marble stairs spiral through the building's core, edged by gold handrails, with light pouring down from windows overhead. When he calls out a greeting to the housekeeper, there's no reply, except his own voice echoing from the walls. The grandeur of the place increases with each step. The sitting room is bigger than his entire home, and even though the views from his back porch are just as good, they look better framed by perfectly designed arch windows. There's an infinity pool with tiles that mirror the bleached-out sky, strings of fairy lights hung between palm trees, and a confetti of bougainvillea petals on the lawn. He's never been particularly interested in art, but the paintings strewn around the place look valuable. The only style he recognises is a seascape by Mama Tulane, his father's closest neighbour in Lavelle Village. He pauses by her watercolour of Jellicoe Bay, which catches the sunset perfectly, the sea turning oyster shell pink. It's only when he's surveyed the entire ground floor that Niall spots an open doorway leading down to the cellar. It's the one place in the Fortini's villa that carries no polish or glitter, with a bare concrete floor and hundreds of wine bottles lying on racks that line the walls. He spots a woman clutching a duster in each hand as he reaches the bottom of the stairs. The housekeeper attends his father's church. She's around 60 years old, her round form wrapped in a housecoat, busy polishing dust from the bottles. She gives him a far warmer greeting than the cleaner upstairs.
"Solomon Niall," the woman says, beaming. "Don't you look fine in that uniform? Come by my house next Sunday afternoon. Both my daughters need a decent husband. You can take your pick."
"I'd love to, Mrs. Jackson, but it wouldn't be fair. I'd sooner take a walk on the beach with you anytime."
"That's a great big lie."
She puts back her head, releasing a loud belly laugh. Niall falls into the pattern of teasing and laughter that he remembers from childhood. He misses the ease of being universally accepted. He's struggled to fit in since his return after years in the UK.
"I'm looking for Miss Fortini," he tells the housekeeper. "Lily Calder's been trying to contact her."
"Is that right?"
The housekeeper's relaxed manner suddenly cools.
"That young lady doesn't listen to anyone. She makes her own rules."
"How do you mean?"
"Miss Amanda's from a good family, but she plays around. When her parents fly home, she's in the bars every night. I can't say a word, even though I was her nanny once upon a time. If she was my daughter, I'd lock her in a room."
"When's the last time you saw her?"
"Thursday, 2 p.m. She wanted crayfish and saffron rice for her lunch, with no dessert and no wine, thank you. Just ice cold au naturel. I bet she had a hangover, that's why."
"Not since then?" The woman looks thoughtful.
"I made breakfast for her yesterday, but she never appeared. Her bed wasn't slept in either. You can draw your own conclusions."
"Is it okay to search her room?"
"Go ahead, Mr. Policeman. It's on the top floor, last door off the landing on your right."
Niall thanks her before saying goodbye. Something about the property unsettles him as he climbs the stairs. Feels ghostly, even though the interior sparkles with light. The place is sterile too, every inch of the floor buffed to a high shine. The bedrooms are all decorated with modern furniture, just a few antiques thrown in, to give the place style. His curiosity piques as he enters Amanda Fortini's room. The bed is freshly made, shrouded by mosquito nets that drop down from the ceiling to protect her as she sleeps. When he looks inside her wardrobe, there's a pile of flip-flops and espadrilles, flimsy skirts and a dress covered in sequins. Photos pinned to a board on the wall show the young woman circled by friends, her blonde hair and smile neon bright. It looks like she's never felt a moment's doubt in her whole life, but Niall knows from experience that appearances can be deceiving. He scans the room again for anything personal. There's a box full of jewellery beside a makeup tray on her dressing table. No sign of a mobile phone. The detective finds a leaflet on the girl's bedside table. It carries information about Lily Calder's reef revival project, which the whole island's talking about. The fishermen have been trying not to damage the coral atoll for years, but it's a losing battle. Soon there will be no breeding grounds for the snapper, lobsters and crayfish that appear on every menu in the Windward Islands. If the coral dies, their livelihoods will perish too. Most of them are grateful that the young woman is putting her energy behind a good cause. Amanda Fortini's personality is hard to pinpoint when Niall scans her room again. The young American has left her purse behind, full of credit cards, yet it looks like she's getting her hands dirty, helping the conservation project. It's only when he draws back the mosquito net that Niall spots something odd. A large piece of coral rests on her freshly made bed, a foot wide, scattering sand across the sheets. It's pure white and feels brittle in his hand. Delicate tendrils starting to fragment. Its saline smell is completely distinct. Someone has used a knife to carve two crossed arrows into its surface. But why would Amanda Fortini dirty her sheets with sand-encrusted coral? She could have left it on her dressing table instead. Niall is still holding the coral when he checks her ensuite bathroom. There's nothing personal there except a faint whiff of citrus perfume, already beginning to fade. The detective's head is so crammed with questions as he leaves the villa, he forgets to say goodbye to the cleaner who's still sweeping the terrace. But she notices the slight. A stream of Creole curses follows him as he walks away.
Chapter 3. I catch the afternoon flight from Gatwick to St. Lucia by the skin of my teeth. I know for a fact that my timing will upset Jasper. He would prefer me to visit his building project instead of jumping on the last connection to Mustique, but my first priority is to support Lily and make sure that my plans for her party are coming together. Once I've reassured myself that details are in place, I can swim and sunbathe to my heart's content until Jasper arrives to help out. England looks grey and gloomy as we take off, but I can feel myself relaxing already. Princess Margaret treated every flight she took as a rest from royal duties and being on show, and I intend to do the same. I listen to an audio reading of Sense and Sensibility and let myself drift. But after a few hours, my concentration is wearing thin, the past crying out for attention. I remember the lead-up to Lily entering our lives like it was yesterday. Her mother, Dr. Emily Calder, was a close friend, until 16 years ago, newly divorced and renting a villa near ours. She was in her 30s with a doctorate from Harvard and a growing reputation as a groundbreaking marine conservationist. Emily spent each summer on Mustique, working on the reef. Everyone adored her company because she was fun, charismatic and clever. I was glad to become godmother to 5-year-old Lily. The child was so good-natured, happy to splash around in the shallow end of our pool, while Emily and I chatted after her long days in the sea. She barely mentioned her divorce, but I still regret missing the danger signs. Emily must have drunk her last sundowner with me, gone back to her villa, then walked into the sea while Lily slept, leaving nothing behind to explain her suicide. No trace of her was found, apart from her sarong, folded in a neat pile on Macaroni Beach. I've never been able to make sense of it. Emily was young and beautiful, with many friends to listen to her woes, yet she threw it all away, abandoning Lily to her fate. I can only assume that she'd been battling with depression but keeping it secret. If she left a suicide note, it was never found, leaving no words of comfort for her daughter. Jasper was quick to agree that we should raise Emily's child. The juvenile streak in his personality helps him to enjoy children's company, and our own brood had already flown the nest. They accepted Lily's presence without question, but her childhood was overshadowed by her mother's death, then her father's disinterest. Henry Calder is an oil magnate who seems to believe that setting up a small trust fund is his only paternal responsibility, rarely bothering to contact his daughter. The girl has sufficient money to live, but she'll never be rich. And she has no one to rely on except myself and Jasper. Yet she's an eternal optimist. She's intent on saving the reef, and I have a feeling that nothing will get in her way. I fall into a fitful sleep, and when I wake up, the captain is announcing that St. Lucia is just half an hour away, but our approach could be bumpy as we pass through turbulence. The plane reels and judders as time rearranges itself. It's just after 5 p.m, the island lagging 5 hours behind the UK. It crosses my mind to call Jasper, but the flight has sapped my energy. I decide to postpone it until a night's sleep has refreshed me. The small airport is heaving with relatives eager to greet family members from the plane, taxi drivers and porters offering to carry my bag for a small fee. I'm about to check in for my next flight when I spot someone familiar in the crowd. It's Simon Pakefield, the British locum who stands in for our beloved Dr. Bunbury while he visits relatives in the UK. The entire island misses Bunbury while he's away, because he's taken care of our ailments so well for decades. Pakefield doesn't acknowledge my wave, even though we've met half a dozen times. The man has an odd manner, pale and poker-faced, with a shock of jet-black hair. It seems odd that his bedside manner is gentle, yet he lacks social graces, always happy to deal with people as patients instead of friends. Pakefield has receded into the crowd when another voice calls my name. My old friend Philip Everard rushes towards me, his hand raised in greeting. The Canadian actor must be well into his 60s, but you'll never guess it. His features look much as they did when he starred in half a dozen stylish comedies that took the world by storm in the late 80s. He's the kind of man who draws attention from men and women of all ages, his open bisexuality only adding to his charisma. Philip is wearing a blue linen shirt that highlights his tan, grey hair cropped close to his skull, his clean-cut features more distinguished than ever. "You're still so dashing, Phil, the perfect leading man." "Not half as gorgeous as you," he grins before wrapping me in a hug. "How do you keep your skin so smooth?" "Lucky jeans and Harrod's face cream." "What on earth are you doing here?" "Lily told me you were coming, so I delayed my flight home, after helping Jasper deal with his nasty French architect." "You absolute sweetheart. Is Jasper okay? I've never heard him so despondent." "He needs you to mop his fevered brow, and is inclined to throw tantrums, so it's business as usual." He looks amused. "I've spent the afternoon hunting for a birthday present for Lily." "What did you get?" "Freshwater pearl earrings and matching bracelet. Is that too boring?" "She'll love them." "Thank God you're coming straight to Mustique, not going to that hellhole Jasper's created." Philip's voice carries a soft French lilt from his childhood in Quebec. "Don't tell me, darling, I need vodka in my system first." "Drinks must wait. There are delays, and we're on the last flight out. They're shutting the airport after we take off. There's a tropical storm heading this way, apparently. God knows why they're so worried. The damn thing's nowhere near us." Philip leads me through the airport at a rapid march, his hand grasping mine. We've been friends for 30 years, ever since he bought one of Mustique's smallest villas, despite having enough Hollywood dollars to build himself a palace. He wanted a bolt hole to escape the paparazzi, but his modesty has never allowed him to decorate it in grand style. Philip was the life and soul of every party and carnival, but recently his pace has slowed. I can't remember the last time he worked. When I watch him arranging our transfer, all businesslike and serious, I can picture him playing a high-minded human rights lawyer or an American president with old-school values. There's a sudden change in his mood as we approach the minute plane that's waiting on the runway. "Did I tell you José's been acting strangely? He's looking after our gardens fine, but he's been following me around morning, noon and night." "That doesn't sound good." "What should we do?" "I'll talk to him if you like." "Let's not terrify the poor boy. I just want him to stop behaving like my bodyguard." José Gómez has worked for Philip and me for the past 5 years, dividing his time between our two gardens. The young man is blessed with green fingers, but mute since birth. I hear him whistling as he tends the lawn sometimes, but he's never uttered a word. Philip seems relieved to get the matter off his chest, grabbing my hand again as the island hopper prepares for takeoff. I've been longing to tell Lily about the party, but keeping my lips sealed. She's fascinated by the old days, isn't she? Mustique's gatherings are legendary in her eyes. This one needs to trump them all. She deserves an ego boost, and is only 2 weeks away. Jasper and I have got designers on St. Lucia making dozens of gorgeous costumes for our guests, including you. Is there a theme? We're calling it the Moon Ball because it should be full that night, and I'm praying for clear skies. I want the island to shine in Lily's honour. No one takes party planning as seriously as you and Jasper. I remember you making trips to Kerala to buy costumes and props for a party years ago. You even hired a yacht so guests could dress at sea, then arrive on the beach looking perfect. It took weeks to build that palace on the lawn, didn't it? Lily's tastes are simpler than ours, but I don't care. Everyone's coming. Royalty, supermodels, rock stars, and you, of course. I smile at him again. It's never too late to marry me. Jasper would never give me a divorce, and you'd leave me for the first pretty boy or girl who crossed your path. Dr. Pakefield is sitting three seats ahead while Philip teases me. The medic is gazing out of the window, lost in thought while the plane's engines roar. Taking off in the 10-seater aircraft is like being catapulted into the sky, but Mustique is waiting for me at the end of our journey, which makes any discomfort bearable. Dusk is already falling, and the captain must be eager to reach the island because landing in darkness is forbidden. The artificial lights of St. Lucia fade as we head south, miles of ocean rippling below us. I don't know why a chill travels across my shoulders when the island drifts into sight. It's still so thick with trees and undergrowth it looks like an emerald afloat on a skein of dark blue velvet. The island's original wildness still lingers in my memory, when feral cows and goats ran through the jungle, the air teeming with mosquitoes. Our plane skims over Mustique's highest peak, then Philip's hand grips mine again as we drop like a stone to the tiny runway. Chapter 4. Darkness falls minutes after we touch down. I can just make out the plane that lies at Mustique's heart, once part of an old cotton plantation, still rimmed by 200-year-old palms. My heart lifts once we step off the plane, to be greeted by warm air and the scent of orchids. Staff are waiting outside the small terminus to welcome us, and the building speaks volumes about the island's relaxed atmosphere. Mustique's glamorous guests arrive and leave every day in high season, yet the building remains simple. Palm leaves cover its peaked roof, the words arrivals and departures daubed on hand-painted signs above two small doorways. The airport manager gives me a bow, not bothering to check my passport, as if I still owned the island. He inquires after Lord Blake with great courtesy, and even though I love the kindness I'm shown on Mustique, it takes so long to exchange pleasantries, I'm relieved to get outside. My butler has delivered my dune buggy to the car park, which has space for only a few cars to accommodate the island's tiny fleet of vehicles. I enjoy walking everywhere in Mustique under normal circumstances, but tonight I'm glad of the transport, when Philip and I set off for his villa with my suitcase on the back seat. The island's smells fill my lungs as we drive. The sweetness of decaying leaves, sea salt, and paprika drifting from someone's kitchens. I can feel my shoulders relaxing already. But Mustique has changed in the 6 months since my last visit. The paths through the casuarinas and lush undergrowth have been paved, and soon the whole island will be crisscrossed with formal walkways instead of the sandy tracks I love. Many of my friends' holiday homes stand empty. There are no lights on in Mick Jagger's property, so there'll be less excitement on the island, and none of the impromptu cricket matches he organises. David Bowie's house lies in darkness too, so trips to Basil's bar will be less fun than usual until both men fly in for Lily's party. Philip's villa lies due west from mine, overlooking Plantain Bay. It's one of the few homes on Mustique with no fences protecting it from the winds that thrash the island in hurricane season. It's named after the jacaranda trees that surround it, still heavy with purple blossoms. Jacaranda is just a simple cottage, clad in bleached timber and topped with a slate roof. It speaks volumes about Philip that he adores the simplicity of the place and employs only two staff, an elderly maid and Jose to tend his garden. He invites me inside for a drink, but I'm keen to see Lily, so I invite him over for a late lunch tomorrow instead. He promises to bring fresh papayas from his tree before saying goodnight. I slow down to listen to the peace on the last stage of my journey through thick stands of trees. There's no evidence of human activity, just the mosquitoes the island is named after. And cicadas chirruping like a round of applause. It's the sound I imagine when I'm in England, that quiet hum lulling me to sleep. Then I hear a new noise. Footsteps, slow and regular on the path behind me, but when I look back, all I can see is a dark mass of palms and the stars gleaming overhead. The footsteps pause for a moment, then draw closer. "Come and join me, whoever you are," I call out. Simon Pakefield blunders out from the undergrowth, I can read his discomfort from 20 yards, shoulders hunched like a schoolboy awaiting punishment. How are you, Simon? I tried to catch your eye on the plane to say hello, but you seemed in your own world. Sorry about that, Lady V. The man gave an awkward smile. I didn't see you. Never mind. Let me give you a lift home. The doctor appears to relax as he steps into the buggy. We're heading in the same direction because he always stays in Dr. Bunbury's villa while he's away. Pakefield talks about his plans to continue our doctor's work during his 2 months on the island, raising funds for new X-ray equipment and to upgrade the medical centre's small ward with new beds and furniture. That sounds marvellous. I'll organise a fundraiser. Is your wife over with you this time? Chloe stayed with the children. We didn't want to uproot them again. That's a pity. You must come to dinner soon. Doesn't pay to spend too much time alone. That's very kind. But my patients keep me busy. I'm fine, honestly. Let me arrange a date anyway. We'd love to see you. When we come to a fork in the path, the doctor says good night and heads back to his borrowed villa, leaving me full of sympathy. Simon Pakefield relies on his wife's social confidence. He'll need extra support during his stay to avoid isolation. The encounter has reassured me that Lily probably imagined being followed home this week. I'm still surprised she chose to return to Mustique after returning from California this summer. The island must hold many painful memories, yet she's determined to use the boat her mother left behind for her conservation work and build up the Reef Revival Charity. I would never dream of wrenching her away, but sometimes wish she could forget the past. My heart lifts when I catch sight of Eden House through the dense tangle of branches. Jasper christened our villa before the first brick was laid, and it felt like heaven to live in luxury after the tents we camped in at first. The three-story house looks striking from a distance, particularly at night, dozens of tall windows glittering in its facade. It was designed by Oliver Messel, an architect famed for his sense of drama and gingerbread style. The pure white building has his trademark blend of modern and classical features, ornate woodwork adorning the roof, and the delicate balconies on the top floor. It looks romantic enough to be a film set for Romeo and Juliet, the marble terrace on the ground floor sweeping out to greet me. The gardens look glorious too, with outdoor lights glancing across the pool that lies on the far side of the lawn, our wooden pool house freshly painted. I call out Lily's name once I'm inside, but no one replies, which isn't surprising. My staff have left for the day and my flight here was delayed. I feel an odd sense of discomfort, even though the quiet elegance of the place is always welcoming. Maybe it's because I've rarely been alone in the house Jasper and I have adored for so many years. There's no reason to be on edge apart from my long journey. I push the feeling aside, then walk through the ground floor. I chose the decor myself, with a little help from my friend Nikki Haslam, whose taste is impeccable. The rooms have tall ceilings and white walls, celebrating the light that floods inside every day. The corners of each room are filled with pieces I've collected on my travels with Jasper and Princess Margaret in India and the Caribbean. Tall mirrors hang from the walls, their silver frames engraved with mythical figures by skilled craftsmen in Jaipur 100 years ago. My spirits are reviving by the time I go upstairs. My wardrobe contains the clothes I left here last time, and our collection of paintings still gives me pleasure. The vivid landscape I bought from a local artist fizzes with colour above the bed, and the delicate vase I found in Japan remains on the dressing table, waiting to be filled with flowers. I could walk down to Britannia Bay to look for Lily in Basil's bar, but combing my hair and putting on a fresh dress feels like too much effort. I take my time, walking down the corridor, picking up objects I haven't seen for months. When I look through the open doorway, Lily's room is less chaotic than usual. An old pair of sandals lie on the floor with some crumpled beach towels, but everything else looks tidy. She hasn't changed the decor since she was a child, evidence of her passion for the oceans visible in every corner. A great white shark launches itself at me from the poster above her bed. And a chart showing different species of tropical fish is pinned to the wall beside an underwater photo of a flourishing bed of coral. Once I'm downstairs, I switch off the swimming pool light, then relax in a deck chair. Starlight is always the best form of illumination. The universe glitters overhead. A million stars like chips of diamante scattered across a giant blackboard. The moon drawing a path across the ocean's surface. The only sounds are old-fashioned calypso music drifting from someone's villa, faint laughter, and snake birds singing their nighttime chorus. It feels wonderful to bask in tropical air instead of Norfolk's autumn cold. My memories of this place are already helping me unwind. Princess Margaret and I often sat here, watching the sunset with our eyes trained on the horizon, hoping to see the fabled green flash in the sea that's meant to appear when the sun vanishes. We never did witness it, but had plenty of fun chatting as we kept watch. When I hear footsteps on the path, I know immediately that something's wrong.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.